back during the Vietnam War, you know, was going on. And actually, at the time, you know, people were being drafted. And so I was in, just got out of high school. So I decided to join the Air Force. Well, basic training was on at Lackland Air Force Base in Texas. Yeah, went down there in, it was July 1970. By the time I got down there, it was June, because I enlisted on the 1st of June. And after that, it was, went to Chanute Air Force Base in Illinois for training, become a metals processing specialist. This is what I ended up getting. And that basically was welding and amongst heat treating and electroplating, and which we did very little of, but it was 95% welding on mostly aircraft parts, jet engines, different parts that were cracked, and we'd have to repair them. Shortly thereafter, to cut down to tech school, lo and behold, they sent me to KISO Air Force Base, just 4 miles from where I grew up. And actually, my father at the time worked at this, as a civil engineer out there at the base, so he sent me right back home. And I was at Sawyer for like 2 years. Once a year, he had to go down to Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma to recertify, you know, so they x-ray your welds. Then the last year, then I was sent overseas. At that time, the Vietnam War was still going on, mm-hmm. but it was starting to wind down, you know, so everybody had served 1 year overseas assignment. So I was very fortunate. I ended up going to Taiwan. We're support maintenance. I mean, 90% of the people that were in the military at the time were in support of the Vietnam War. We didn't actually go in country, but, you know, everybody freaking was there to do their part to support it. Because at that time, they had a base there that was in support of the Vietnam War, a lot of C-130s that flew out of Taiwan to, for, you know, supply missions and that. And although it was a Taiwanese air base, but the U.S. pretty much had possession of it at that time. Yeah. And the C-130s that we worked on, they come back with bullet holes in them. Well, I tell you, Taiwan is a fantastic country, beautiful country. I mean, I felt a little guilty being over there because it was, I hate to say this, but I felt like you were on vacation. The culture is completely different there, you know. It's, mm-hmm. it's just get kind of used to the culture, just going around town. And, you know, I mean, and the people were super friendly. You go anywhere, do anything.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everybody's friendly to you, except when you left your house, sometimes people would break into it, steal your stuff.
But,
oh. You know, or if you had a pet, you had to make sure that you really kept a close eye on them, because over there, they eat everything, was the name of the city. And we had to live off base. Well, it's a kind of sad story, but there's a second lieutenant, they lived right across the street, because there was no base housing. We had to live down in the city we were in, was Taichung. Everybody did. So anyway, the people across the street from us there, that second lieutenant, he had a German Shepherd puppy. And he had it for a few months of that, about 6 months, but they eventually just disappeared. You know, so you didn't know what happened to it. So to Taiwan, that, looking back at it, it was, for that time period, I was very fortunate to, you know, be able to go to an area like that. It's totally different than the United States, but you know, it's a very beautiful country. I mean, they have some of the highest mountain ranges in Southeast Asia there. They have snow year round up in the mountains.
Then while I was there, Richard Nixon there made a deal with mainland China to normalize relations with mainland China. So, but part of the deal was all U.S. forces had to get out of Taiwan. My ex-wife there, she was also in the Air Force. And we were sent to the Philippines, Clark Air Base in Philippines for, I think it was like 3 months.
That was kind of different. You had to watch your back there. Any American at that time really had to be kind of careful what you did in that. So. Okay. But fortunately, we weren't there all that long, and just 3 months. So Clark Air Base at the time, you know, was the main hub for bringing, you know, POWs back. In a lot of the bodies from people from Vietnam too. So I got to see some of the POWs come back from Vietnam. I mean, it was just the last of them. Majority of them had already returned. They had a big, large area of just coolers to keep the bodies in, like a cargo area. Then we served the rest of our time there. We were discharged at that time, as soon as we got back to the United States. I think it was like 3 years and 10 months or something like that I had actually served. But a lot of people were getting early outs because they were trying to downsize the military after, you know, Vietnam.
It was a different time, you know, and military people that were in Vietnam were kind of frowned upon, you know, that it wasn't our fault that we were over there or in support of it, you know, but, right. You know, like when we came back, there was no fanfare, no nothing, you know, and took your uniform off and you just kind of hung in the closet, and that was the end of it, you know.
And then spent the summer just kind of looking for a job and ended up getting a job at the Children Mine for the next 36 years. Well, within a few recent years, you know, I mean, they've, you know, like the plates they have going to the monument in D.C. there, the, you know, for all the veterans. Yeah, you know, it's cause back then, even when, like, when I applied for jobs and that, my military service didn't come for nothing. You know, that I was trained and all that stuff. You know, I remember some job applications, you know, I put in, they wouldn't even consider that in your military service. And although with Cliffs, when I did get hired with Cliffs, they, you know, they did somewhat recognize that at the mm-hmm. time, you know, that they didn't have to train me.
Right.
You know, spend all that money that they're already trained. So it was a little easier, you know, to get a job at that time. But
right.
But I was fortunate then, back then too. I mean, the mine was just opening and it was just, they're hiring all kinds of people. So it's just, things just kind of fell into place, you know. Overall, it was a great experience, you know. I mean, one of my sons went into the Navy, you know, because when he got out of high school, he was kind of like, he didn't know what to do, you know, where to turn or nothing like that. And I said, well,
right.
Just, you know, try the Navy, you know, see, you get to see the world and you get to try out different things and, you know, maybe you'll come up with something useful, you know, become an electrician through the Navy. So when he got out, he got a job as a lineman. I mean, I think, you know, things now are totally different.
Yeah.
When you go in the military, because the volunteer nature of it. Back then, all sorts of people were being drafted, you know, so they had all, Air Force had all kinds of extra people.
Well, within a few recent years, you know, I mean, they've, you know, like the plates they have going to the monument in D.C. there, for all the veterans.
Right.
You know, they're giving all those people, you know, a chance to go there. And hopefully, mm-hmm. sometime here soon, I'm hopefully going to be able to get on the list there. My grandson's going to be 18 this year, and he's going to go with me.
Okay.
You know, because...
Okay.
And he'll be my chaperone, I guess. Pretty good experience, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't really want to make it a career, because I didn't want to go travel everywhere all the time.
Right.
You know, and but, you know, I'm a Uper, so that's where I came back to, you know.